that keeps you company like a warm syringe. But when the age hits your head, it's a cold sensation. Hi, this is Ted Axe, and you're listening to Bloodshed with the Vampire on Metal Messiah Radio International. And I'd like to congratulate Metal Messiah Radio on its 13th anniversary.
Mr. Vampire, Ted, you are very welcome. It's a great pleasure. I'm very proud to have you here on the Bloodshed with the Vampire on Metal Messiah Radio International.
Well, how perfect is that? The Count of Rock talking to the DJ Vampire.
Ted, to be honest, I was not much familiar with your music until Robin asked me if I want to interview you. She said, Vampire, would you like to interview the other vampire, Ted X? And I said, sure, bring him on. And yeah, she sent me your music, which I've been listening, and I believe me, I love so much. And I like to thank Robin, our beautiful 24/7 PR, for this great encounter with you. And thank you as well for this interview, Ted.
Thank you very much, DJ Vampire. Yeah, I really appreciate you taking the time to contact me tonight. And thanks very much to Robin.
Okay, Ted X, aka Height, you was born in UK, London, and grew up in Ottawa, Canada, son of a Canadian diplomat and vocalist, multi-instrumentalist with an original style and an amazing lead guitarist. You are also a prolific writer with a catalog of over 100 songs. Ted, I'd like to take the opportunity to dig deep into your biography, especially for fans and younger fans. How did you, Ted X, started as a rock musician, and how was the rock and metal scene back then in Canada?
Wow, that goes back quite a ways. Well, not to give away my age, DJ Vampire, but it did start quite a while ago in the womb of my mother. My great-great-aunt was Lady Bathory, who was a prolific serial killer in England, and she used to tell me my great-great-great-aunt was Lady Bathory. Having said that, when I came out of the womb, I was really kind of a nervous kid, and I was always banging on stuff. So I learned to play the drums quite early, and then started guitar in grade 5. Well, my mother always told me, you'll never amount to much, because everybody wants to be Mick Jagger. Mick Jagger, dime a dozen, she would say. So the more she said that, the more it encouraged me to become a rock musician. Well, I started playing guitar in grade 5. I was so bad that they used to unplug me from my amps, and I'd be playing, thinking I was playing along, and then when it ended, there'd be nothing because they'd unplugged me already. Well, that did discourage me. I went on and on, and I started going to local exhibitions, the summer exhibition in Ottawa, Canada, where I was transferred from England, and I started trying to get into a black soul band that was playing on the Midway. It was like a black strip band called the Copper Tone Review. But they wouldn't let me because I was white and I was only 16 years old and I wasn't a member of the musicians union. But it was really kind of cliche. It was like this big fat guy with Alabama plates and a limousine asking me if I wanted to get in it. But after that, DJ Vampire, I got in a punk band. After my trip to England, I went back to England in 76 and came back with a bunch of tapes of punk stuff and kind of started a punk band in Ottawa. It became Canada's first punk band.
Okay, Dad, let's move very slow with this. Don't go too fast. Dad, yes, going back to my question, how was the metal scene back in Canada? Around the same time that you was practicing with your guitar, was banging on drums and things, how was the scene there in Canada?
The scene really hadn't embraced punk yet. It was something something that was happening in England. And there was only a couple of punk bands in Canada at the time when we started getting in trouble. There was no punk scene. It was kind of a hard rock scene. Definitely some metal happening. A lot of cover bands.
Who were the bands that were... Are we talking about what year now? That
1976, 1977.
Go back to 1976. What were the bands then that were the big guys there? In the metal scene.
Yeah, in Canada, the big metal guys were...
I mean, rock, metal, whatever. I mean, the Rush.
Yeah. Oh, well, you know, Rush. Yeah, definitely Rush was the big export in Canada at the time. Stadium bands like Loverboy was another one. Rush. Christ, what else was there in Canada? Anvil. There were some punk bands as well. DOA was starting, and a band called Teenage Head in Toronto. But really, we were kind of glam. Punk bands had long hair. And so they kind of going, cut your hair, cut your hair. Yeah, because it's supposed to be punk. But we were coming out of, like, you know, little rich hippie kids. So we weren't really punks. We were kind of into, we'd been doing Rolling Stones and stuff like that.
Okay, Ted, how is it being, at least at the time, trying to be in, yes, a rock musician while your father is a diplomat?
My father was the Canadian ambassador to Mexico and Venezuela, I believe, as well, and Guatemala. I lived in Mexico for 2 years. I guess 21 years old. That's why I lived in Mexico for 2 years. Went to an international school. And I think it is a kind of rebellion against that.
How was the feeling, or how was the way your father was taking that?
Well, my father kicked me out of Mexico.
Oh, no.
Yeah, yeah. I was going to school there at an art school. And I visited the embassy. I would go back and forth from this university and visit my father every one, maybe once every 2 months. And I came back and he showed me this top secret envelope from the RCMP, Royal Canadian Mounted Police, had sent him a warning. And inside he said, I want to show you this. This is a warning from the RCMP. And he said, your son is involved with drugs. He's involved with rock. We think you should get him out of the country because he's going to ruin your reputation.
No.
Yeah, yeah. So I saw it myself. So I was kind of flabbergasted that I had made such an impression. And I was closely being monitored by the Royal Canadian Mounted Police, who had warned my father to get his son out of Mexico. So the next thing I knew, I was in the back of a limousine going to the airport with two motorcycle police, the Mexican police, making sure I didn't escape. Anyway, that was funny in one sense, but on the other sense, it was kind of tragic because I didn't talk to my father for 8 years after that.
Whoa.
He was mad at me that it caused a bit of a rift between us. But having said that, I think that's where my rock impetus comes from. It's that kind of rebellion against this conservative diplomat, this diplomatic lifestyle. I was really wanting to get away from that. It's kind of like the prince and the pauper, where the pauper wants to be rich and the rich kid wants to be the pauper. It's kind of like that fable, really.
How was this moment when he had all these elite encounters or meetings and you are with him at that time? Yeah, like a punk rocker instead of like him with tie, with your suit.
The funny thing about when I was in Mexico, I was really kind of more of a hippie. I remember wearing a lot of bare feet in the embassy, and I would arrive with bare feet.
No.
And I'd have a group of hippies with me. Yeah. I had long hair, and I still look like a punk rocker, but it was definitely kind of the Santana maybe look more than the Sex Pistols at the time. But it didn't stop the Royal Canadian Mounted Police from thinking I was a danger to him and getting him out of the country. But I don't think he reacted very well. He didn't like it. He certainly wanted the other type of son, the one that would have a tie and a suit on.
I believe so. But I believe nowadays he's very proud of you.
Well, he's dead now, so I'm sure he is. Yeah. But
before he passed away, you guys was good in a good relationship.
Yes. Yeah, yeah. When I went back to Los Angeles, he was already living in Los Angeles. So that's when we reunited and we had a really good time for those last years of his life where he just accepted me. The funny thing is he got Alzheimer's at the end, and that's when he really accepted me. I guess he didn't really remember who I was. And he used to embrace me, and he said, oh, my dear friend. And that's what I thought I was closest to him, when he didn't really remember who I was. But isn't that the way it always goes, father and son?
Yeah, but the good thing is that you guys could spend some time in good terms, give each other the love needed for many years before he passed away.
Right, absolutely. We closed that rift. We had had been incommunicado for 8 years.
Yes, for people to get to know you much better. That, I mean, over the years, you get yourself famous as a swaggering leather clad figure with eyes hidden under a veil of black hair and a half-cooked top that had dances to the tunes of a dirty Les Paul, venting poison with a hail of feedback. You shriek with a razor tongue, a sneer that ignites the crowd. Who or what inspired you to have, yes, captured this or conducted yourself to this stage personality, becoming and being this swaggering count of a rock and roll character?
Well, I think I was always kind of theatric. I was into theater. I was always into vampires because my mother was from Hungary. She was born on the Hungarian-Transylvanian border. And as I said, I had a bit of a background in vampire ancestry. So I was always into that. Also, my childhood was quite violent. My mother being a bit of a hitter, quite a violent woman. In fact, the most angry person I've ever met in my life was my mother. So she was making me full of angst. So I had to release it somehow. And I became kind of, yeah, very much known for my stage antics in the action. They would say Ted Axe is known for his stage, his wild stage antics. And I remember we played a high school in Canada, which was around the high school was cow pastures and graveyards, because it was in a very small town. And I came into this high school and started pretending I was vomiting. And I had this stuff called green slime that you could get in the toy store. I was making it kind of my mouth. So I was like, and then I ripped my pants, my leather pants ripped, and I claimed that my genitals were exposed. Of course, nothing like that ever happened. So things like I was smashing pumpkins because it was Halloween. But after that, I phoned up the papers myself. I was very influenced by Malcolm McLaren, the manager of the Sex Pistols.
Dad, to go further with this great conversation, yes, as you said just now, you formed a band back then, I mean, under the name The Action, which got the punk music movement going in Canada with some rather sensational headlines in, yes, the Ottawa newspaper, and the band released their four-track EP, TV Is on the Blink. That was back in 1977. And the band knew how to get the press going, and you guys have toured your homeland and the United States, and the band has also toured alongside punk legend as the Stranglers and the Ramones in 1978. Ted, please, could you tell us how did you start this punk rock band? How was the experience, I mean, back then when you toured with these legends? I'm talking about the Stranglers and the Ramones.
Yes, that was very interesting because at a young age, I was attached to a beer bottle and I really can't remember too much of the tour except getting in trouble and fights, all this kind of punk stuff. We thought that was very the way to be. I was very frustrated in the band because the band, they stuck together while I was on the outside. So I was kind of me against the three brothers with the drummer. And the brothers were very kind of, you might say, straight, laced, and really kind of reluctant punks. We had to kind of coax them into being more punky than they were. The great thing, however, about The Action was that we had a slide guitarist, which was completely different from anyone else. And so we ended up sounding like a very punky Rolling Stones mixed with the Ramones. My slide guitarist would play in open tuning, kind of like the Stones do, with Keith Richards always being in open tuning to play the slide. And so it gave us a unique sound. And I tried to make up for their conservative attitude by being more and more of a punk. And I think that's what got us into trouble. As I said, we were always getting into fights backstage and stealing beer from the headlining bands. It was a great experience. And after that, we did get signed to a label in Montreal, Canada called Montreco Records. But it turned out that the label was owned by the mafia. So we had a bit of a problem there.
Yeah.
Didn't make any money, you know, organized crime or disorganized crime. And so that ended abruptly when it all blew up.
Yeah, but talking about label, what happened to, I hear that EP that you guys released back then, and very great. What happened to that 45? Was it 45 LP, right? The small LP they used to release back then in the days.
Well, I'll tell you what, Jacobo. I've come across recently people who say, we didn't know that was to be played on 45 when we've been playing it on 33 RPM, because it came out as an album, but it was an EP of four songs to be played on 45. But people didn't know that, and they played it on EP, so it sounded like Sisters of of Mercy or something, very slow and ominous. But it really was the only thing we recorded. It was a four-song EP featuring our hit TV's on the Blink. Mm-hmm. That's really the action hit. You can look that up on YouTube and you'll hear it. And four songs, Do the Strangle, Teenage Downtown Boy, Do the Strangle, TV's on the Blink, and a cover of Lou Reed's Waiting for the Man. So that's what the album was. And we recorded it live in Montreal in a studio where Mahogany Rush had just come out of. That was a big Canadian band back then, kind of like a Canadian Jimi Hendrix. But as I say, people didn't know what to do about punk back then. They thought, well, maybe we should spit on them or we'll throw our beer on them. It was all kind of secondhand in Canada. Canada was full of mounted police, beavers, hunters, tartan, checkered shirts, and very conservative kind of atmosphere. So we wanted to cause some trouble, and we got banned from radio stations, and any trouble that was in the club, we got blamed for. And I made sure of that, because that was the way to get ahead in punk rock. Unfortunately, the band broke up before we... My plan was to go to London and try to live there and try to make it there with the band. But unfortunately, it broke up, which led me to where I am now.
Okay, talking about that, I mean, when all of this was going down, rock and roll was only 20-something years old or so. No one was thinking about maintaining a legacy or even working their way into some Hall of Fame nonsense. The action became inactive after 1 year. But you, Ted, took your razor tongue antics elsewhere. You stalk the stage of London and Los Angeles and then form this little punk band, Sister Height, in Seattle, where you released Sister Height 2007, Sex Change in 2013, and My Own Worst Nightmare was released in 2016, if I'm right here. Ted, please, how was those years, I mean, in London, Los Angeles, and Seattle? And tell us more about the band you formed then, Sister Height, and the albums released and shows done with your band.
Yeah. Well, after the action, actually, I formed a band in Toronto called Chroma Key, which I don't think you know about. I wasn't the vocalist. I wrote the songs and played guitar. We had a female vocalist, and that was the 80s sound. It was very kind of David Bowie. Actually, some of my most eclectic writing was in that. And then after that, I had a band called Teddy Day and the Zoo back in Toronto, which was before Sister Height. And then Sister Height came about when I moved to Los Angeles. Los Angeles, I lived in Los Angeles for 12 years in Hollywood, and I became a film extra as well as a musician, trying to supplement my income. I was in films like Batman and things like that as an actor. LA was very saturated at the time. It was just coming out of Sunset Strip sound with bands like Guns N' Roses, Poison, and LA Guns. And we backed up LA Guns and bands like that in Hollywood. But it was so saturated. It was very hard to get a show on a weekend. You'd have to play during the week or on a Sunday. And a lot of the times they wanted you to pay to play at the Whiskey or Go-Go.
Yeah.
I wasn't having any of that. And I said, no, I'm not going to pay. What do you think? I'm a punk legend. So we didn't have to pay ever. But as I say, it was very saturated. So it was about maybe 400, 500,000 bands all trying to get somewhere. And it was like a bunch of cars in a parking lot spinning their wheels, never really getting anywhere. And that's the way we felt about Los Angeles. You know, everybody was trying to be somebody they weren't, because we all wanted to be that Sunset Strip, you know, Guns N' Roses kind of thing. Now looking back at it, it all seemed terribly dated and very kind of generic, because everybody looked the same and sounded the same. After Los Angeles, I moved to Vancouver, and Vancouver, Canada is very full of hippies. And so I couldn't get anybody who didn't have a beard and who could remember the tunes, because everybody was so stoned that I didn't find the right look for my band. So I wanted to move back to the States and move back to Seattle. And that's where I formed Sister Height. And Sister Height, again, Seattle was very kind of grungy at the time. Nirvana had just come out. That's where we are right now. So coming back into Seattle, where I lived for 9 years, Sister Height was born. It was like a glam band in Seattle, which is like finding a raised toilet seat in the Vatican. Wasn't supposed to happen. And so we were kind of, again, getting in trouble, ruining clubs and causing riots, that type of thing. But Sister Height was really kind of glam, very glam. So I was wearing a lot of makeup and a lot of eyeliner and stuff. Today, of course, I look very natural. And after Seattle, the action reformed.
Dad, it's so great to hear all your stories that you went through. I mean, to become the superstar you are nowadays.
Of course. I'm more of a star now than I was in the action.
We always start somewhere, believe me. that your numerous fans call you the Count of Rock, and no other name could be more appreciated than this, that you combine elegance with rebellion, refinement with transgression, and elements that puts into large doses even in your music, and that are part of your new fantastic album that has a shocking yes title or Sex, Horror and Violence. But before we talk about your new album or this album, your latest album, Ted, don't you mind to present us who are the members that complete your band now?
Yes, absolutely. Marcel Lafleur is the lead guitarist. He's very much of a rock and roll veteran in Toronto and very well sought after. And Julio Biafore is the rhythm guitarist. Corrado Bartolo is the bassist. And Stefan Ford is the drummer. And such a bunch of dedicated fellows you'll never meet in your life. And on stage, they're incredible. They're very serious musicians. I kind of carry the show. And when you go to a TEDx show, you might find a lot of smoke on the stage, a lot of flashing lights, that kind of thing, lasers. And then the promoter will introduce me as the legendary TEDx, the Count of Rock. The band will start, and then I'll come out.
Okay.
And it's the same with the last song. I'll leave before the band finishes. So I'm off the stage when the band does a big ending and finishes the last tune.
Okay, that sounds very, very great. I mean, it makes me want to see your show.
Well, that's the idea. And we're getting a lot of feedback from the audience. So the more energy that comes back from the audience, the more you put out. I'm lucky because I give it my all every show. So during this lockdown, Toronto's in a lockdown right now, I'm not really frustrated because I gave it, you know, everything I had on the last show. So I am maintaining myself. I can't perform right now because all the shows are canceled. Where you are, is there a lockdown there?
We had a lockdown there? And it's still like 40% are still locked down. So we didn't start moving 100% and we will not, I think, maybe till the half of 2021 or even the last part.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Yeah, talking about this great new album, the band's last album, Sex, Heart of Violence, released last January 2019. I mean, some media said that the album was released independently, and some said that it's via Eclipse Record, which is an American independent record label based in New Jersey. But I mean, I'm gonna ask yourself, what's the truth? Is the album released independently? Is it released through this label? What is the case?
Well, it was producer that was going to start his own label, not Eclipse, but Eclipse Records.
Okay.
Eclipse, yeah. So Eclipse Records has not been formed yet, because as soon as he was going to start it, coronavirus started. And we were just on a new recording. We had just started recording another EP with Rob Sanzo, who is the producer, and he had done Sum 41. That's his claim to fame, and he's worked with Didi Ramone and a bunch of people. And he was going to start his own label called Eclipse Records, but it hasn't happened yet. So there are some reports that say we're with Eclipse, which is not a fully fledged form record label. So I would have to say that it's independently released until the end of this thing happens.
Yeah.
that going over to what this album is about, I did listen to the whole album, Sex, Horror, Violence, a 12-track album, and yes, I understood what the lyrics is all about. Remind me of this strange case of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, which is a gothic novel by the Scottish author Robert Louis Stevenson, referring to a person with an unpredictable dual nature, unworldly good, but sometimes a shocking evil. Perhaps the song Sex, Horror, Violence referred to a man that had read the newspaper and went out and bought a gun. The world had gone crazy and the man went downtown and started shooting everybody. Hurt people. Then you had this, death do us apart, says it's an institution, a final solution. It's a pain in the neck. You will get yours. Then you have mother saying she will cut you down to sizes again. She will crush your heart and lay your soul to waste. And so on. Complete album describe these kind of behaviors in human beings. Ted, my question is, yeah, what was you thinking about? Or what inspired you when you was writing this lyric for this album?
It's interesting because most of the album was autobiographical. Some songs like Mother's Day were certainly autobiographical, where it was about my own mom and most angry person I've ever met in my life. And the lyric there goes, take her out and leave her somewhere else. Because I wasn't very happy with, you know, her. So songs like My Own Worst Nightmare and Hurt People really involved my attitude at the time, where it was a very kind of interior anger that motivated me. And so I always thought a song like Hurt People, where it's about someone who hurts people because they haven't gotten over their childhood trauma, so they bleed all over everybody else during their life. A lot of people like that, as we know. So Hurt People goes, hurt people, hurt people. That's really, you know, the gist of the chorus. My Own Worst Nightmare is in a similar vein. It's about that kind of Jekyll Hyde persona, as you mentioned. So it is kind of that Jekyll Hyde persona where someone's their own worst nightmare. And then there are, you know, there's a few good songs also like Death Us Do Part is really about marriage and the pitfalls of marriage, the institution of marriage. And we have a video recorded for that on YouTube, Death Us Do Part by Ted Axe on YouTube. And yeah, it is filmed in a graveyard. So gets the point across.
But let's go back to the album. I mean, seeing that because this COVID thing, this Leafs record has not been ready as yet to start working, that means that the album was released independently and have been released independently in what formats? I mean, after years, a year or what, but in what formats are this album available?
Unfortunately, there is no hard copy, only because we were playing shows and we were at that point thinking of, should we make a CD because people might want a CD. But most people, as you know, want only something that's available online. And even though there would have been a CD available, I think most people would reject it. There's only a few people that really want CDs. Everybody wants, you know, something on Spotify, and it's available on Spotify. There's a playlist you can add to your playlist on Spotify for absolutely free. Now I have my own site on Bandcamp, tedaxe.bandcamp.com, and the album is available as a virtual album for $10. But hardly anybody is buying that these days. I remember back a few years ago, I had a lot of virtual albums sold, but now because of Spotify, you can just go on and get it for free. So really, it's only available online as far as digital tracks.
Okay, let's see when this COVID is over, that this Ellipse record is back. Will there be a re-release of this album?
Absolutely. And I think we just started doing 4 new tracks, and those are almost complete. They only need lead vocals and background vocals and to be mixed. So that will resume after this is finished. We'll go back into the studio and finish those 4 tracks, and then that'll probably be added to the Sex, Horror, Violence album. And at that point, I think there will be available on vinyl as well as a CD.
Talking about what you just said about digital, but I still believe, I've been in Europe so many times, people like likes hard copies. They want CDs. They want vinyls.
I don't know the case in Canada,
but in Europe, vinyls are very popular. So I think that's a great idea to still get this great album on a hard copy.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I think you're right. And Europe is really where we want to end up touring as much as possible, because the funny thing about Europe is that although hip hop is embraced, it's not the only thing. There's really a much more of an appreciation for rock in Europe. The other great thing about this album is that it was done on analog 2-inch tape, like the albums from the 70s, which I'm so influenced by. That gives it kind of a warmer sound as well. I don't know if you find that.
Yes.
But it's very subtle, but the recording on 2-inch tape is much better, because there's no computers in the house. It's all tapes going around.
No cassette tapes there.
No cassettes available at this point.
Okay. Sex, Horror, Violence was produced by Sum 41's Rob Zanzo, a musician and production engineer from Toronto, Canada, and mastered by LA rock icon Jack Atlantis. You work with producer Rob and mastering by Jack in putting out this album together. Describe, yes, how was it for you, your experience working with these two great legends?
Oh, yeah, it was an amazing experience. Rob Zanzo has this attitude that he wants to do something completely opposite of what's popular. And he wants to do something completely opposite of what the kids like. That was kind of punk in itself. And that's really the only way to come out with something unique, you know, something original. Because otherwise, people are always trying to do something that's really not them. They're trying to fit into a mold. And the other thing is about him is that he's very mellow. And really a refreshing experience to deal with someone that doesn't have any anger issues. A lot of producers, I find, and a lot of well-known ones, are full of privilege. And they like drugs like cocaine, things like that. And that usually ruins the session. Cocaine is a kind of insidious drug that's still around in the industry. And you find people who are legendary always have usually some kind of cocaine habit. So it's great not to have that around, because it really ruins things. Usually people are waiting for the drug or waiting to get it or too stoned. It causes all sorts of anxiety and confusion. The experience with Rob Zanzo was really great, because he was very against doing something that was typical.
Yeah, I remember Sum 41. I mean, he had a lot of success, producing for this band, and this band has its great golden years, I must say.
Right, absolutely.
But how about your work with Jack Atlantis?
Well, Jack's been a friend of ours for a while, and he mastered it, remastered it, and kind of brought it out of a muddiness into a very clarity-oriented sound. And yeah, it was great. He did a great job. He is a guy in LA who has, he tours Europe in his own Bauhaus tribute band, and he also does the Cramps. So he does a kind of a double tribute in England every year. He can't go this year because of the virus, but that's what he does. And so he knows all about the sounds and how to get great sound in his mastering.
Yeah, the band had many shows. That was, like 2 years, a year ago, after right. The release of the album. For this year, COVID started and all two shows, festivals were canceled. Ted, are you still planning and doing shows next year in the cycle promotion for this 2019 album, Sex, Horror, Violence?
Yeah, absolutely. We want to continue shows when this is all over. So we're not really sure when that's going to be. Our band is still as strong as ever, and we've been communicating during this virus. We haven't gotten together at all, but we're ready to do shows and resume where we left off. As I say, we'll be going back into the studio, completing a 4-song EP, and that will be called The Count of Rock.
Okay.
Yeah, that's going to be a new EP. And I think it's great format, because people these days are so, they want something so quick. I think 4 songs is almost enough, as opposed to 12. You know what I mean?
Yep.
So I think that's the way it's going to go in the industry. People are just going to want something quick. And so that's going to be great. This new stuff has got a hit called Will We Get Out of Here alive. It's really about what's going on now, as well as a romantic relationship kind of intertwined. I believe the new stuff is even better than Sex, Horror, Violence. Either it'll be added to this new album, to the album Sex, Horror, Violence, or The Count of Rock. We're ready to do shows, and we want to get over to Europe as well.
I believe, with all due respect, that that will be very great. I mean, if you can get a new EP out instead of just
edit
music to an older album.
Of course, I think so too.
Yeah.
Something new. The fans want something new. I also have a Ted Axe Fangs group. I believe you're a member of that, aren't you? You're a Fang.
Yes, I saw it.
The Fangs group has 3,300 women on it, and they are all staunch Ted Axe Fangs, and they're going to be wanting something new. So that's going to be a really great thing for us because we've been waiting so long. On the Fangs group, Ted Axe Fangs group on Facebook, we'd like everybody to join because the more fangs I have, the better. I don't have just fans, I have fangs. You know, F-A-N-G-S. DJ Vampire, you should appreciate that.
You can bite.
Yeah. I'm a bit tired right now because I've been out all night. I'm not supposed to be up right now.
You don't get to sleep early in the nights.
Right, I'm waiting for 12 o'clock midnight to go out again.
Ted, yes, to conclude this interview, I want to thank you very much. Yes, to have made this interview possible, I want to hand you over the microphone of Metal Messiah Radio for you to invite all your fans, to support the band to buy this great new album, Sex, Horror, Violence. If you have not as yet, please do so. But before we end this interview, Ted, for fans like Yes to know, what kind of equipment do you use and do your band use when playing?
Well, it's interesting, Jacoba. I have to tell you that Sex, Horror, Violence, I usually record by myself and bring in a drummer. Because I can play guitar, bass, and some drums, I usually record myself and then bring the music to the band and have them
practice.
Yeah, do it themselves. Bring their own thing to it. But that's the way I record, and I've recorded the last four songs like that as well. Yeah, well, I use generally a Marshall half stack as an amplifier and then mic that. I usually use Gibson SG or a Gibson Les Paul, which I have. I have a Gibson Les Paul. It's called The Les, and it's just wood with no paint. It gives me kind of a really lush sound. And yet my SG is the opposite. It's called an SG Gothic by Gibson, and it's got crescent moons on the neck, a vampirish, blood red guitar. And it gives me a total opposite sound. It's very kind of electric and edgy. So those two guitars give me the sound I want. And I use stuff like a wah-wah pedal and an overdrive to get the effects I want. But it's really a Marshall Gibson sound. And then my drummer is very Led Zeppelin, kind of John Bonham. That's the kind of drum sound I like. Really, that's the kind of gear I use. Of course, the mics, I have no idea what they're using in the studio. But it being analog gear, that makes the difference. Because the 2-inch tape gives it that 70s sound. And my influences, of course, are Alice Cooper, David Bowie, New York Dolls, Mott the Hoople, stuff like that from the 70s, T-Rex. And it's really never changed. And then we add, you know, the funk of James Brown in there, and also a bit of Black Sabbath on that album. So those are the kind of influence that I'm dealing with. That gives it the glam and the dark sound.
To conclude this interview, Ted, once again, I want to hand you over the microphone of Metal Messiah Radio for you to thank whomever you want to thank that.
Oh, great. First of all, I'd like to thank you and Metal Messiah Radio for including me in your interview.
You're welcome.
Thank you for taking the time and for doing all the research on me. That's really amazing. Most DJs don't.
I told Robin, don't get nervous or anything. Vampires knows each other.
Right. I'd like to thank my fangs, also the Ted Axe Fangs group. Some of my close friends are on that now, and it is maybe 3,000 plus women on there, and those are the ones that comment on my pictures. Those are the ones that buy the music, like the music. I don't have too many men. It's very strange. I'm not sure why. I think they might be a bit jealous because I'm getting a lot of attention from female fans. And really, all I do is I try to do 2 new pictures a day and put them on the Fangs group. And unlike other musicians, my image is propelling it along. Sometimes I don't even need the music. It's just the way I look that seems to engage people. Certainly the women are engaged by it. And a lot of them wish that every man could be like me. But having said that, it's great to have that, because if I didn't have it, at this point, I wouldn't know what kind of interest I had. So it's great to have some fans, isn't it? It's great to have a bunch of people that love your music and love you and the way you look. So I'm really appreciative for that. And I'd like to thank my band for sticking in with me in this great depression we're all in. I haven't seen either of them, any of them, for the last 8 months.
Oh.
We've been communicating online, but we haven't got together so at all. So we check in every now and then, you know, everybody okay? Yeah, we're all okay. We're waiting to start again. We're on the sidelines, you know, waiting to start again. So that's great. And they really have a lot of faith in me. So I'm really proud of that.
Having said that, I wish you all the best for this coming year. I wish you all the best with the new music for the new EP. And I want to thank you. I'm not sure if this was a premiere on my show revealing this EP that will be released this coming year, the 4-track EP. But I still want to thank you for have shared with us that great news. And I'm looking forward, believe me, keep me posted. And so you can premiere the first single of this EP.
That'd be great. Looking forward to that. And it is going to be premiered on your show.
Oh, thank you very much, man. And, you know, I can't wait for this cover to be over so I can start touring again, going to festivals, going to shows. And yes, hope to see you sometimes. Yeah, I hardly go to North America. It should be when you guys go to Europe, and I'm in Europe. I will be looking out to see you guys.
Where are you located?
I'm located in the Caribbean.
Oh, the Caribbean. Aruba, right?
Aruba, yes.
Yeah. Great.
I'm at least once or twice a year in Holland since we are Dutch.
Oh, great.
And from Holland, yes, you know, we are always all over in Europe.
Of course.
And I invite you, know, so we can meet in Europe to go to Transylvania.
Yeah, that'd be good.
Our ancestors.
Of course. And I hope you have a good feeding tonight.
Yeah. We're going to go for the hunting.
I'm getting my fangs sharpened up. I can't wait. I'm getting really hungry.
That I think I finally got to interview someone that understand me, understand my kind of living, my world that I'm living in.
Right.
And absolutely. I wish you all the best for all your plans. Yes, it was great to talk to you once again. It was great to have you to come into my dark land, this dark side that we love being in. Looking forward to see you. Yeah, what else can I say? I mean, I wish you all the best.
And we'll talk again, I'm sure. And thanks again for playing my songs on your radio show.
Yeah, you're very welcome. And like I always say, metal on. Bye-bye.
Thanks very much. Cheers.